Welcome. My name is Andrew Fawcett, and I'm a member of the Heroku Developer Relations team here at Salesforce. In this demo, you'll discover how Heroku gives AI agents superpowers by combining Salesforce Agentforce agents with the ability to build powerful coded actions powered by Heroku. To understand the importance of this, we'll explore how Ultra Construction, a company with 60 years of history, used Heroku and AI to unlock valuable insights from their vast amount of archived and unstructured data. Some of their oldest customers are getting frustrated by the sales reps' lack of awareness about their past engagements. For example, when the agent is asked questions relating to invoices dating back between 1980 and 2000, it's unable to provide any answers. Fortunately, Agentforce relies on a discrete set of actions described to the AI engine, allowing it to interpret user questions and execute one or more of these actions, effectively coded functions, to deliver an answer. When a question arises with no matching Salesforce-supplied action, custom actions come to the rescue. Developers can build these in Apex or Flow, and if the required data resides in Salesforce and the complexity and compute needs are small, both of these are good options. In our scenario, that isn't the case. So, let's log into their Salesforce environment and take a look at how Heroku has improved the situation, followed by a dive into how it was coded and configured within Agent Builder. So here we see the amazing Agentforce agent in action running in Sales Cloud. It's able to answer lots of questions relating to this account. However, when Harman Consulting me up and start to reflect on their past spends with the sales agent prompt for additional information does not provide the answers they are expecting. Agentforce is now thinking about all of the actions that can provide an answer to this question. And right now, because we haven't taught it the Heroku powered one, we'll get a response stating that it appears there's no records available for invoices between January 1st, 1980 and December 31st, 2000. Now, Ultra Construction's Agentforce builders and developers have discovered that their older information is stored in the cloud in various file archives, in various unstructured formats such as Word, PDF, and images. Ultra Construction doesn't need this information imported, but does require it to be accessible by their agent. Now, Ultra Construction's developers know that Java has a rich ecosystem of libraries to handle such formats, and that Heroku offers vertical scale needed to process and analyze and extract all that data in real time. So we're going to come back to the code in a few moments, but first I want to show you the impact of this new action that it's had on the scenario that I just showed you. The Java action has been deployed to Heroku and made available to the agent as an action. So the final step left for us here is to deactivate the current agent configuration and install our new action, which we have defined down here as query historic archived invoices, into the agent's available list of actions. Then once we activate the agent, we can go and refresh to bring in the new agent configuration and ask our question again. So this time, in amongst all the Salesforce supplied actions, is included our new Heroku action, which is calling out to Heroku, accessing all of that information, doing some computational based on our answer, and has arrived back at the answer of $787,000 has been spent between 1980 and 2000. Fantastic. So let's take a deeper dive into the code that we built to make all of this happen. So here we are looking at the Java code that drove this particular action. And in this case, it's a REST endpoint. We have some inputs and some outputs, specifically the request coming in from the agent and also a response coming back. And we built this using Maven, so we were able to access a number of libraries, including the Spring Boot library, which allows us to build APIs and add persistence and querying and all sorts of other features very easily into our application. And we also included the Apache project POI, which allowed us to process some of those documents, as well as an additional Spring framework that allowed us to create some documentation and OpenAPI schema. So the Java code essentially queries the information or retrieves it from the archive, stores it into a persistent database, which is actually an in-memory database in this case, or you can configure it with Spring to be a persistent database. And then we're using ChatGPT, and we're using Spring AI to make it super, super easy to call out to AI. So we've constructed a prompt which includes the user's query in plain English, but it also includes some other instructions to the AI. We want a SQL statement out of this because we've just loaded the extracted archived information into an in-memory SQL database. So we want something that we can run against that based on the English language query given. So we give it some instructions. We also tell it a bit about the schema. So it knows there's an invoice table, there's an invoice line table. And it goes away and creates that query response. And then that SQL query is run against that in-memory database, and the result is a JSON payload that gets responded to, that gets sent back to the agent. So we can take a quick look at the document parser. This could really be anything. It could be PDF, it could be spreadsheet, it could be text file or an image, whatever you want to use to parse that information. You can use these libraries in Java or any other language supported by Heroku. So in this case, I'm taking a folder full of these documents, which for the purposes of this demo is this folder here. And it's getting hold of all that information and writing that into the in-memory database. And lastly, we have a helper function here, which just simply takes the schema from the in-memory database and puts it into a string that we can pass through into the ChatGPT function. So with three classes, we've created a fairly sophisticated way to ingest from unstructured archive data, store that in an in-memory database. If we wanted to persist that to avoid some of that processing again, we could do that with a config change. It's as easy as that in Spring Framework. And then we've used natural language to SQL AI with ChatGPT to get a SQL query that will return the results that we need. So let's give this a go. And I've been running this locally on my machine, and I've configured it only with my OpenAI key API key and nothing else. It's running the in-memory database, so it's ready and listening. And as I mentioned, we also have set up a documentation facility for this, and this is all completely generated by including that library in our POM file. And it gives you a nice UI for testing it. So I don't even have to move into Salesforce straight away to test this. So we can click try it out. And I've already defaulted it to what is the total invoice amount for all the invoices. And I can click execute. And it's now returned the answer. And if I go back to my IDE here, I can actually see through some of my console output. There is the prompt added to the AI. There is the prompt that was given in the API call, and the SQL query that it ran is actually included here. So that's actually the schema that it used. The SQL query is here, a very simple SQL query, but it can get more complex the more complex the queries that you ask. So it generated the right SQL query. I can see that with my knowledge of SQL that that is the correct SQL, and it returned the right result. So that's how things are running inside my localhost. But once I've deployed this to Heroku, and I can use a regular CLI command, git push Heroku main, simple as that with Heroku, and it's up and running in the cloud, I can then use Salesforce to get hold of this API and connect it into my agent builder. So let's take a look at that process. But before we leave that, I want to point out one other thing. If I click this link here, I get this text. What it actually is a description, a machine readable description of my API, the inputs and the outputs, and it's actually compliant with OpenAPI spec, and the technology within Salesforce supports this format. So again, I got this from just including the Swagger library in my project. It automatically parsed all my Java types and my method signatures, with a little bit of extra annotation from me for descriptions, and arrived at this. So what I did next was to put this into external services. And we were able to do this because we have the open API schema. So it's been slightly better formatted here, but you can see, again, the open API schema. And if I click save and next, you can see that it also determines that there's a query there. And then eventually it determines that it's going to generate some Apex types, which actually you don't ever have to see. You can just use them within the Flow technology. So that's the external services side. It's point and click. As long as you've got an open API schema for your Heroku API, then you're effectively point and clicking your way, connecting through to Heroku. Now, there is one more thing before we move on, that you have to create a named credential. And pretty much every service that you put out on the public internet should have security. And again, Spring makes that super easy for you to configure. So I've gone ahead in the sample that we'll be sharing here and just set up the basic authentication with a hard-coded username and password. But in Spring, you can configure JWT and OAuth and all sorts of other configurations really simply, really easy. You don't have to be a major expert in all of those authentication protocols. Spring Security takes care of all of that for you. So we'll go through more of the things that you have to click through in Salesforce to get to these dialogues in the README files associated with this sample. But I did want to call out that in addition to using the external service, you do have to create a named credential. Otherwise, Salesforce will not authenticate with the service. So the final thing we need to do, and this is kind of in the moment thing right now, is that we have to create a flow to wrap around the service that we've just imported. So this is the invoice query API from Heroku, and it's been imported by the external services that I just showed you. But in order to make that visible to Copilot right now, or rather to Agent Builder right now, you have to create a flow action around it. This is roadmapped to be removed in the future. So if you're watching this video in that future, you may well find you can just completely skip this step and go straight from an external service straight into the next bit of the demo, which is defining the Agent Builder action. So this is the Agent Builder action, and you can see that I picked the flow that I created. That's the name of the flow that I created just now, and that's the flow that calls the external service, that calls Heroku. And the interesting thing about defining agent actions is you don't have to do any more coding or any kind of authentication or anything like that. None of that's needed here. That's all done with by now. But what you do have to do is give it a description of what it will do. And this isn't just for us humans in the future. This is needed by Agent Builder at runtime when it's parsing all of the different actions that are possible. It's giving this text to an AI that says, here's the available things you can do based on the query that the user's asked, which of the things you want are best suited to actually execute to get the answer. So we've been given it a reasonable description. And we've also given it, in fact, sorry, that's the description here, the ability to extract, query, and calculate information on historic invoice in, details. And we're also telling it about the inputs that required, basically pass the query that's entered into the agent directly through to the service. But this is a quite impressive piece, at least, that I found, was we're only returning JSON from that API. Yet when you looked at the demo I gave you earlier, it's actually got formatted text. It's a natural language. It says, oh, well, here's the total amount in dollars formatted correctly for 1980 to 2000. Well, the way that this works is it intuited from the text I gave it here. I said, look, the response is in JSON, extract the value and display it accordingly based on the query the user made. So the AI that's running behind the scenes created that natural language response. I didn't have to do that in my action. I just responded with the data that was needed from that action, which I think is super cool, because I didn't want to get into trying to format that text or the values or anything like that according to the query. And frankly, I didn't know what the query was, because I used ChatGPT to generate the SQL and just give me an answer. So that's a pretty cool feature of setting up an agent action in Salesforce. Once you've given it the action and you map the inputs and outputs, give it some really good descriptions, and you'll get a great experience out of that. So what I'm going to show finally here is a little bit more of information of how we map that into Agent Builder. So Agent Builder uses something called topics, and topics house your actions. And the topics are essentially containers for actions that do similar things. And in this case, I've only got one action associated with this particular topic, which will be effectively this action here. But there could be other actions. And the principle is that here again, you can do some classification description to describe what your actions do. So for example, you might create an action that goes off and parses some other archive information, maybe in a different format, or it's a different type of information. Maybe it's a legal information or a contract of some kind. And then you might add new actions to this collection of actions that specializes in processing archived information. So it's a great additional extensibility feature, our topics. And again, it's pure text, but careful what you type into this, because it really matters in terms of the experience that you get out of Agentforce. Okay, so with that, let's move into wrapping this demo up. And what did we just see? Well, step one, we saw the agent send a request. It was the request actually I entered. What is the total invoice amount on planning meetings between 2000 and 2010? Actually, that's a slightly more advanced version of what I entered. But it resulted in Agentforce building an execution plan for my actions, and it chose my action because of the descriptions. And then I used external services and Agent Builder and a bit of flow to ensure that action in Salesforce, in Heroku rather, gets invoked. And I use that open API to do that. And open API is an industry standard for describing APIs to machines. And that is exactly what we used it for. And then we wrote some code. And in that case, this was Java code using Spring Boot. We used the AI library to easily call ChatGPT. We used the Spring security library to make sure it was secure. We use JPA and H2, which is an in-memory database, very optimized for running in Java, very low footprint, but very powerful. And we use the Spring.org docs library to generate that UI that you saw me test the API in, and ultimately it generated that open API schema as well. And then, of course, that Java code went off and read some of that historic information, and that's where I custom coded, going and reading some of that invoice information using additional Java Maven library, and that inserted that into our in-memory database. And then we said, okay, well, here's the plain English request by the user around this information you've just obtained. Can you turn that into a SQL query? And sure enough, we got a SQL query out of it and executed that and returned it back to the agent. So if you are interested in exploring more of this example or others, please do check out the QR code on screen. It's our Heroku reference applications page, and each reference application contains a README file with detailed instructions on how to set it up. It includes architecture diagrams, such as the ones you've just seen here, and more, and also any links to related content, such as the blog that this particular video is going to be associated with, and lots of other interesting information about the technologies that were used in each reference app. So please check that one out. And in the meanwhile, thank you for watching, everyone, and have fun supercharging your agents with Heroku. Thank you very much.